Hey everyone, I'm very excited to be here today as this is the first video in my series of VMware Cloud Foundation's fundamentals. In this series, I'm going to help you master what VCF truly is. And if you're uncertain of what it actually is, think about this. It's an on-prem automated approach to building a data center or a software-defined data center. We're talking everything from vCenters, hosts, ESXi, VDSs, storage, all that sort of stuff, automated for you as long as you get it right. And that's my aim from this series, to help you really iron out those details so you can repeatedly do this and save thousands and thousands of hours. Now, on that note, we're going to cover things such as architecture, configuration, deployment, troubleshooting, and even some design. So if you stick it out and walk through each video as I release them, I will quickly tell you that each video will probably have 1 to 2 slides and then go straight into demo and then close off. But this one specifically is all intro and architecture. I really recommend you stick out through this video and then move on to the next ones and come back to them as you need them, because they all do link into each other and it gives you an entire picture of what VCF truly is. Okay, let's jump right into the content. Module 1. I'm going to take you through an overview of what VCF is, deployment architecture types, VCF regions, management and workload domains. And within the last section of management and workload domains, we'll also look at availability zones. So VCF is essentially an easy to build on-premise private cloud. And I say easy to build because a lot of the bring up and lifecycle is automated for you. There are 2 new appliances introduced with VCF. That's the Cloud Builder appliance, which is the appliance used to build the initial 4 hosts of the domain, or management domain, I should say. Or if it's the consolidated architecture you're going with, the management and workload domain, effectively. But that'll be clearer in the next few, or the coming slides. SDDC manager is essentially what you use to build the subsequent workload domains, deploy vRealize suite, all the other lifecycle management stuff that you would normally do or will be doing. VCF follows the VMware Validated Solutions, or VVS for short, which is also or was formerly known as the VVD, VMware Validated Design. This is essentially a set of principles and deployment architecture, which is best practices defined by VMware for deploying your various domain zones and configuration of various items. It also covers stuff like regions and availability zones. I will place a link to the VVS in the description of this video for you to have a look at later on. VCF covers 2 deployment patterns, consolidated and standard, which I'll cover in the coming slides. Deployment architecture. The consolidated architecture is essentially a collapsed management and workload domain. You need a minimum of 4 hosts, and those are the first 4 hosts that you will build with VCF regardless. It's quite literally just a small checkbox in the deployment spreadsheet to tell it which type of architecture you're building. This type of architecture is ideal for small environments or even proof of concepts. I've personally seen customers use it for remote locations as well, where they don't have such a big footprint and want to use VCF. There are other use cases where within a core data center, it's a proof of concept or a dev test lab, something like that. But there are many use cases for the consolidated architecture. Just because you go with the consolidated architecture doesn't mean you can't later on expand with dedicated workload domains. You can do that using SDDC manager. And really the only difference between consolidated and standard architecture is the consolidated creates additional resource pools within this cluster to have basically dedicated resources for your workload VMs, whereas the other resource pools that are also created are for your management VMs and all that sort of stuff. So it's giving you the ability to carve out resources for the different tiers and types of applications or appliances. The standard architecture. You've got a dedicated management domain of 4 hosts. Again, it's the same 4 hosts that you would initially bring up with Cloud Builder, similar to the consolidated approach. All the future management appliances, so we're talking about the vRealize suite, vCenters, NSX managers, all that sort of stuff, will be spun up and deployed into the management domain. Then using SDDC manager, you go and create additional workload domains after the initial bring up of using Cloud Builder. Then you can, within a workload domain, expand with additional availability zones. Now, this isn't really limited to just workload domains. You can expand availability zones in your management domain as well, and I'll get through all that shortly. VCF regions. This is my take on trying to explain a VCF region, because it can be a little confusing to some, but essentially a region consists of either a consolidated or a standard SDDC built, a VCF SDDC I'm talking about here. Each SDDC instance is considered a region regardless of the deployment model. So what I'm trying to get at here is an SDDC instance consists of the objects deployed and managed by a single SDDC manager. So let's say you've gone and built a single instance of SDDC manager, and that SDDC manager, he's managing a management domain and three workload domains across different data centers. All those together combined equals or is one VCF region. And then the more of these, as you bring up more regions, more vCenters, more NSXs, more NSX instances, I should say, regions can then be federated using NSX federation. There are obvious caveats and configuration maximums from doing so. We will cover them in subsequent videos, but essentially, at the time of recording this video, NSX will allow you to federate a maximum of, I think it's 16 sites. So that's 16 NSX instances across different SDDCs to be federated, or that can be federated. Management and workload domains. As I've mentioned, the initial management domain consists of four hosts. And in this section, we're actually more so talking about the standard architecture than the consolidated, because within the consolidated, you don't have the segregation of management and workload, as I've mentioned. So the management here, we've got the first three appliances that are spun up, vCenter, SDDC manager, and the NSX managers that are deployed. The vRealize suite, which I've also added there, is just there for completeness. It's actually a day two operation. So you have to log into SDDC manager and deploy the vRealize suite after the fact. When you spin up the workload domain, it creates or deploys another vCenter. The workload domain doesn't. SDDC manager orchestrates the deployment of the vCenter and NSX managers. These appliances are placed in the management domain or in the hosts that are constructed for the management domain. Within the workload domain, we've got NSX edges and then workload VMs. Now, this is just the first workload domain that you'd create. Any subsequent workload domains that are created will have their own vCenter deployed, and they're all linked together. So the management one and the workload one are all linked together. Then the second workload domain's VC is also linked in there, all using enhanced link mode and single sign-on domain. But you do get the choice of whether or not you want to deploy additional NSX managers for the new workload domain or reuse the existing one for the first workload domain. A very important thing to remember here though is it is mandatory to deploy the NSX managers for the first workload domain. You cannot use the management domain's NSX instance. It's just not something that you can do, but you can go on to the additional workload domains and reuse the first workload domain's NSX instance. Availability zones. Within a workload domain, you must have at least one vSphere cluster. Otherwise, you can't really create the workload domain. So a workload domain it consists of one or more vSphere clusters, and an availability zone is essentially at least one vSphere cluster, regardless of which domain a data center it's in. So as I've mentioned, a VCF region can be spread across different DC locations, and the way you can do that using availability zones is to either deploy dedicated VCF clusters within the workload domain across these data center locations, or you could also stretch those the VCF clusters from one location to the other. And what that gets you is a single logical VCF cluster, which allows for vSphere HA, DRS, an active-passive approach. But that does require, as I've listed in the typical multi-AZ approach, stretch vSphere clustering, stretch networking, stretch vSAN, then you need a witness node. And then regardless of if you do dedicated clusters or a stretched one, you can use a single, or you will be using a single NSX instance. In the next couple of slides, I'll use a couple of diagrams to really iron out these details. The first one we've got here is a multi-AZ stretch vSAN cluster. So picture this, you log into vCenter and you've got one logical cluster, but it is actually spread across two data centers. That's what the multi-AZ stretch vSAN cluster does for you. And that gives you the ability to, as I said, use vSphere HA to fail nodes from or workload from one DC to the other without really having to do anything. But you do have an active passive design in this. So DRS rules are automatically created to hold all workload in one location. The reason for this is it's really important to make sure whatever you do from DC1 to DC2, you have enough resources allocated for the failover to work, for vSphere HA to work. So what happens if DC1 goes down and you've gone and manually created workload in DC2, and now you've not got enough resources storage-wise to have those VMs fail over? Your vSphere HA event fails. So that's why it's important to know what's happening and the resource allocations and all that sort of stuff that you've got going on in your environment, and which is why it's generally recommended to do the active-passive approach. And then again, this requires stretch networking and storage. The caveats being, in my mind personally, I don't really like stretching networks anymore because it can cause issues in the underlay of the networking, spanning tree loops, broadcast storms. You name it, there are protections against it. It's up to you how you choose to design that. But you've also got stretch vSAN, and I've already talked about the resource requirements. And in this design, you also need a third location, wherever it may be, for a lightweight witness node to help with quorum voting. So, and it's there essentially because you don't want a scenario where you've got split brain. What happens when one data center goes down and the other one doesn't know about it? It thinks it's active and the other one is actually active. It helps iron out all those details and essentially make sure your cluster is healthy. This is the non-stretch version. So two data centers again. You log into a vCenter this time, but you've got two different logical vSphere clusters. Cluster 1 or cluster A and cluster B. You can't use vSphere HA, you can't use DRS between them because they're two separate clusters. Those two functions work within a single logical cluster. So that means you've got no automated failover, but in this case, you can have an active-active design, which is ideal for load balancing. And you're not really relying on infrastructure to take care of HA. You're configuring it in the application layer. And then you've also got no stretch networking or storage requirements. But in saying that, you've got something like NSX, which is the SDN solution, which allows you to have network availability across two sites without having to stretch every single VLAN because you're using overlay networking. The only network that needs to be stretched is the TEP network or the overlay network to allow the transport nodes to communicate with each other across sites, which we'll cover in subsequent sessions. And really, this is just the end diagram, just to bring it all together. This is a multi-DC architecture encompassing VCF regions and availability zones and workload domains. And effectively, I really wanted to iron out the picture. So you can see VCF region 1, which consists of an SDDC manager, management domain, workload domain, and a stretched workload domain with two AZs. VCF region 2 is just within DC2 this time, and it's essentially the same thing minus the last workload domain. That's really how I sort of wanted you to visualize how the regions can work together in different locations and not be part of the same SDDC instance. But this will all become clearer as we move on. All right, so we're almost wrapped up with module 1 now. We've covered a fair few things in this introductory module. So we've talked about a bit about regions, availability zones, general architecture, VCF constructs, and the appliances it uses. If you would like to see something specific in this course and you think it may not get covered, please leave a comment below. Even if you would like to just say it was a good job or you like the content, leave a comment below and hit like. It really helps me out to know that I'm on the right track. And also, I would like to know which way or which direction or what other content the viewers out there would really want to see. Thanks for watching.